Hi, and welcome to the next lecture unit in the lecture chapter on nonlinear or kernelized support vector machines. So this is a more mathematical lecture chapter, which provides some theoretical background for the kernelized support vector machine. It's probably one of the more challenging lecture units. I also won't be able to go totally into every detail because of, time constraints. So if you want to know more about this, have a look at one of the standard books about support vector machines, but this will take some extra time. But at least I want to roughly introduce what we mean by the reproducing kernel Hilbert space, and I will also provide a short proof of the very important representer theorem. So I introduced kernels already as symmetric positive definite functions that take such a pair of observations and map them to a real value. And I also said that the kernel can be thought of as a shortcut computation for a certain two-step procedure where we do the feature map first and then compute an inner product between the two feature mapped versions of our observations. And now there's a very important theorem of Mercer's from the beginning of the 20th century, I think it's from 1909, which says now that for every kernel there exists an associated well-behaved feature space where the kernel acts as a dot product. So in a certain sense, that tells us that what we are doing with all of these kernel functions here is mathematically reasonable, and there exists a space here where the kernel really acts as a dot product. So Mercer's theorem is a little more detailed than what I'm discussing here, but for us here, introduce Mercer's theorem is by saying the following. So there, for each kernel function of such type here, there exists a Hilbert space, capital phi, of continuous functions, that go from curly X to R. And what do we now mean with Hilbert space? So with Hilbert space, we mean an abstract vector space. So it's a vector space that's also endowed with an inner product. And this inner product can be used to introduce a metric. So if we have an inner product, we can now basically measure angles. We have a metric, which means we can now measure distances, and it has a further property, the so-called completeness property. And that means that every Cauchy sequence with respect to the norm induced here by this inner product actually converges. And this is actually quite a non-trivial fact, especially for infinite dimensional cases. But what these properties basically tell us is that we can, in a certain sense, now do linear algebra and calculus in these types of spaces, which means we can, use all or many mathematical operations we are being used to from linear algebra, from geometry, and from calculus, and especially for SVMs, this is all that we need. And on top of this, that Hilbert space, there now exists a continuous feature map, which phi, which maps every element of our original observation space or original feature space, curly X, to that Hilbert space here, so that the kernel actually does compute the inner product of the features in that Hilbert space. So the kernel is now really such a shortcut computation. Before, we were always kind of missing the fact how this feature space here actually looked like, and that what we were doing there is really in our product, and Mercer's theorem basically now guarantees this for us. And this is very, very nice. What is not so nice is that this here is basically an abstract existence type of theorem. We don't really have an idea how such a Hilbert space might look like, and there's actually many possible Hilbert spaces and many possible feature maps, all for the same kernel function, but luckily they are all in a certain sense equivalent or isomorphic. It is still often helpful that we have a certain reference Hilbert space for a certain kernel, and this reference Hilbert space we call the reproducing kernel Hilbert space, the RKHS, and that can in a certain sense be explicitly constructed. So for the RKHS, we would always use the following feature map, which maps an element X here to a continuous function, which looks like this, where we basically take our kernel function and then we bind the first argument to X and this second argument here, that's variable, okay? And we now take the space of all continuous functions here of this form as our Hilbert space. So the features of the reproducing kernel Hilbert space are basically all these kernel functions here evaluated at X. So this is actually mathematically, I would say, quite complicated, you know, in a vector space where your vector elements are actually functions. And the Hilbert space is now the completion of the span of the features. So we take all of these elements here of curly X, we map them via our operation phi into functions of this type here. Then we compute the span. So we compute everything that we can produce by a finite linear combination. And then we complete the whole thing. So we make sure that all Cauchy sequences converge. And this and the result of these all of these operations here, this would be our RKHS, and that basically ensures that it has all of the properties of the Hilbert space. And it's called reproducing kernel Hilbert space because there's this reproducing property here, which states that if we take a kernel function, an element here of the Hilbert space of this type, and for a certain point X and for a certain point X tilde, and then we compute the inner product in the space. Now this also looks like this, and it also can simply be abbreviated by the kernel being evaluated at X and X tilde, and that's a super useful property for us. So this reproducing kernel Hilbert space now provides us with a very useful interpretation. It basically tells us that an input X is basically mapped to a basis function that looks like this. And this is best illustrated with the Gaussian kernel. So if you have two points here, in this case, maybe even one-dimensional points, which simply live here on this real line. So you have this green guy here and you have this red guy here. What the phi mapping now does is that it maps this single point here to a bump function of this type. Yeah? So this single point here gets mapped to this guy here in Hilbert space. And I guess you can also see that this Hilbert space is now of infinite dimensionality, right? This is not a finite structure anymore. We are now mapping this red guy here to that function. And if we now compute the dot product between these two guys here in Hilbert space, we now know that we can do it also here in this form. And this basically means that, for example, we take the, I can interpret it in two ways. For example, we take this here as our X, and we now have we have this green function here, which is variable in the second argument. And now we enter in the second argument the position here of this red guy, which means we have to read off of this green function here, this height, and this is now the resulting computation of our kernelized inner product. I guess you could have also done this in a symmetric fashion by saying, hey, this red guy here is mapped to this bump function, and then we enter the green guy in that function. That, of course, because of symmetry, we get the same value. So some extra comments here. So we have to watch out a little bit. So not all elements of the Hilbert space are actually of such a form. As you can already see, I had to do a lot of like completing operations here. First of all, I had to do the span, and then I had to do this further completeness completing operation. So watch out for this a little bit. What we do know is that a general element in the span, as I said, is a finite linear combination of these things here, and then a general element in this completing closure of the span takes such a form here, and here, be careful with this. So here I have to now produce infinite sums. So I also have to make sure that this stuff here actually converges, which it would under this extra assumption here that the infinite sum over the squares of the coefficients here is actually finite and converges. You can see this becomes technical rather quickly. One useful extra calculation. So if we know that we have two elements in our Hilbert space, which are linear combinations of these basis functions here. So it's basically a linear so here we have a finite number of points of your original input space, training observations, so to speak, and you map them into your Hilbert space via this phi operations, which gives you these guys here, and then you form a linear combination of these, and this would be the F. And then you do the same for other observations, do another linear combination, and you now get another second element in the span in your Hilbert space. What happens if you now compute the inner product between F and G? And there's a very, very nice simple formula, which I've written down here. This is basically the full proof. I will not read this out because this is super simple. So the only thing that is being used here is that the inner product has the property of being bilinear. So it's linear in the left component and it's linear in the right component. So we can draw scalars outside of the left component and the right component. We can also draw sums out of these components. And I'm just doing that here. And then at the end, I'm simply using here this reproducing property. So I can directly write it as a kernel between x, y, and xj. And what you can now see is that the kernel basically defines arbitrary inner products between all elements in the span of the basis functions. Yeah. So if you know that this f here can be written as a linear combination of these elements with these weights, and here you have for g these elements and these weights, if you want to now compute the inner product between f and g, you have to compute all of these you have to evaluate the kernel for all of the pairs where an element comes here from the left-hand side and here from the right-hand side. You also have to multiply these weights, and this gives you a direct nice computation for the inner product between F and G, which is super useful. Okay, short context switch here. I want to discuss another extremely important thing for support vector machines, which is called the representer theorem. So remember that I have basically only demonstrated to you how the solution looks like for the linear or the soft margin SVM, and I have then kind of pretended that I can simply rely on the fact that the same maths also holds true if I use the kernelized support vector machine. In a certain sense, I have to be a little bit careful here because, as you have seen from the comments before, I'm quickly now going into infinite dimensional vector spaces in my feature mapped space. So maybe this is not so simple, but the representer theorem tells us this, that everything is still okay, and we can, state directly what it says, and then you hopefully will see also the immediate structural connection to the linear support vector machine. So assume that I now want to solve my primal quadratic program for my support vector machine, which looked like this here. So we had this quadratic regularization going on the vector theta, Here we have our sum over the slack variables, and here we have our hyperplane constraints with our slack variables on the right hand side to relax the constraints because we always want to use this soft margin version of the support vector machine. And what I'm now already doing here is that I'm now saying, hey, I actually don't want to do this in my original input space. I want to go into my I want to perform my feature map here and go into my generated feature space. Now, what the representer theorem tells me is that I can still write my solution vector theta, so the optimal theta, as a linear combination, a weighted linear combination of now the feature mapped versions of my original training data points. And usually this is going to be a sparse sum as for the original linear soft margin SVM because of the structure of the Hinge loss. And this is not completely trivial because, as I said, these phi operations here, they might map into an infinite dimensional space. And also in that space, now my theta here lives. Okay, so can we prove this? Answer is yes, it's not super difficult. So let's assume now, or no, let's not assume it. Let's now state the representer theorem. So the representer theorem really tells me, this is basically just a restatement of this thing here, that my solution here, this theta vector, actually fulfills that it is inside of the span. So the linear span of these elements here, phi of x, I. And let me prove this now on one slide. So first of all, let's give this linear space, this span here, the symbol capital V. And now let's consider V orthogonal, which is the, orthogonal space to V, which means that our complete vector space, capital phi, can be written as a direct sum between V and V orthogonal. So we know that from linear algebra. That also implies that our vector theta, so what I'm now saying holds true for any vector here in capital phi, and therefore also for our vector theta, has a unique decomposition into components V, small v, and small v orthogonal. So we can write theta like this here. And we will now simply consider what happens with our optimization problem if we insert this representation here of theta into the optimization problem. So first of all, our regularizer, because these guys here are orthogonal, simplifies to this here, because if we calculate V transposed times V orthogonal, that's going to be zero because, they are orthogonal, okay? So we can write down our norm of theta, or the squared norm of theta, simply as the squared norm of V plus the squared norm of V orthogonal. Now, I can do a second simplification by considering now the constraints. So if I look at the constraints of this form here, I can now insert for theta this form, which means I have a part V here, and then I have an added part V orthogonal. I also know that this inner product here is bilinear, so I can take apart the sum into two single terms. And now I can make a very nice observation, and this is that V orthogonal is orthogonal also to all of these guys here, because V orthogonal is from a space that's completely orthogonal to the span here, so it must also be orthogonal to all of these elements in the span, which means that all of these guys here, it's not all of these, it's basically it's only one guy here, but this element here becomes immediately zero. which means that all of my site constraints now do not depend on V orthogonal at all. So what happens now is if you insert this here, I guess maybe also really do this with pen and paper, so you have this on one page in front of you. What happens now is that you, if you insert here in this problem your V plus V orthogonal, you obtain kind of the same SVM program now simply being written in V. And then this guy, and then, well, this guy here doesn't make reference to V or V orthogonal. This, all of these constraints now only make reference to V. And here we have squared norm of V plus squared norm of V orthogonal. So that basically means we have now the still the support vector quadratic program in front of us in terms of V. And in the objective function, we still have squared norm of V orthogonal, and we also have to kind of minimize that independently. But if there's not like no site constraint on that and nothing else refers to this, we now immediately know what we have to do with V orthogonal. Well, that simply has to be zero, right? Because if there's no further constraints on this and nothing else refers to it, there are no further side effects. So the best solution must be if we simply reduce V orthogonal down to zero, which means theta is then exactly V. And as V is from this span here, we have proved exactly what we wanted. So what we now, because of this very nice representer theorem, know is that we can actually restrict the SVM optimization problem, although we are potentially in an infinite dimensionally Hilbert space, to a finite dimensional subspace of this span here. So basically, that basically tells us that we only have to operate on coordinates, weights in front of these guys here, and these were exactly the Lagrangian multipliers that we considered in the dualization of the linear SVM. And what the representer theorem tells us that we can also do exactly the same thing for the kernelized support vector machine, which in a certain sense acts in infinite, potentially infinite dimensional vector spaces. So we can really assume this form here for our optimal vector theta. And we also now know how the SVM prediction looks like. And again, this is the same form I also discussed before for the linear and also for the, well, I discussed it also before for the kernelized support vector machine, and there I said, hey, let's simply assume that this really acts like a dot product here, which we now do know. And again, with a similar argument, we can also show that as for the linear SVM, that the sum is likely going to be sparse because of the specific structure of the hinge loss. So we have still for the kernelized support vector machine, well, exactly the same type of structure in front of us as for the linear one.